Johnny Cash changed the face of country music. He changed the face of American music. He changed the face of world music. And he also changed the lives of a great many people. Over the years, his life and his art became one and the same. He tried to live his life and make his music with integrity and honesty and total frankness. That included his ability and his willingness to admit his human failings. Johnny Cash was many things, but a hypocrite was not among them. He remained lifelong true to his ideals and to his vision. His story has been told, but what has not been told is his remarkable spiritual odyssey. It is the story of a man's faith that was tested many times, but that endured and finally glowed with a bright flame. I'm Dan Rather. Everyone knows Johnny Cash, the myth. Johnny Cash, the legend, knows the man in black. But not everyone knows the humbler side of Johnny Cash, the seeker of faith.
Yes, I know when Jesus saved me,
saved my soul.
The very moment he forgave me,
made me whole.
He took away my heavy burdens. Lord, he gave me peace within.
Peace within.
Satan can't make me doubt it.
I won't doubt it.
It's real and I'm gonna shout it.
I'm gonna shout it.
I was there when it happened. And so I guess I ought to know.
My friend Johnny Cash was truly a man who sought truth his whole life. He began with the faith his mother taught him when he was a little boy in a small frame house in a cotton patch in Arkansas.
February 26, 1932, in a little house surrounded by cotton fields. My father was a cotton farmer, walked behind the mules with the plow, and I did that as well. It was a family thing. Everybody in the family worked in the fields. Even the girls did. There's some sweet memories and some sad memories too, but it was a good life.
One night, one cold winter night, the rain had been falling. The river kept rising and all the old folks kept saying that Mississippi River's gonna break that levee. One morning the levee broke at Wilson, Arkansas, and that black, muddy Mississippi River water come right up over the cotton patch, right up to the front door of our house. And I heard my daddy holler and ask my mama, "How high is the water, mama?"
2 feet high and rising. "How high is the water, papa?" She said, "It's 2 feet high and rising. We can make it to the road in a homemade boat. That's the only thing we got left that'll float. It's already over all of wheat and oats. 2 feet high and rising. How high is the water, mama?" 3 feet high and rising. "How high is the water, papa?" She said, "It's 3 feet high and rising. Well, the hives are gone. I lost my bees. Chickens are sleeping in the willow trees. Cows in water up past your knees. 3 feet high and rising." "How high is the water, mama?" 4 feet high and rising. "How high is the water, papa?" She said, "It's 4 feet high and rising. Hey, come look through the window pane. The bus is coming, gonna take us to the train. Looks like we'll be blessed with a little more rain. 4 feet high and rising. How high is the water, mama?" 5 feet high and rising. "How high is the water, papa?" She said, "It's 5 feet high and rising. Well, the rails are washed out north of town. We gotta head for higher ground. We can't come back till the water goes down. 5 feet high and rising. Well, it's 5 feet high and rising."
John's music explored the major themes of country music, and indeed of all America in recent decades. Prison, railroads, Native Americans, the lowly and oppressed, the open road, love and life and death and damnation and salvation and God. These were the themes John returned to again and again. Though he faltered and he wandered throughout an explosive life and career, he always came back to the faith that he sought. John lived his life with an angel on one shoulder and a devil on the other. John was haunted his whole life by his big brother Jack's tragic death in a sawmill accident when Jack was just 14. Jack had been John's hero and had declared that he was going to be a preacher.
If it hadn't been for losing Jack, there's no telling if he ever would have gone on to sing the songs that he sang with such heartache, you know, related to so many people, you know, his suffering so easily because it was on his sleeve. He had a great understanding and closer spiritual relationship with God because he came in and studied in Jack's stead. And though he continued to sing and followed his heart's desire in music, he still delved even deeper into studying the Bible, my father did, in life, because I believe that he had that desire to be who he believed Jack would have been.
The Air Force got him out of Arkansas, and he saw a bit of the world while stationed in Germany.
I went to Deutschland, and I stayed there so long I felt like a citizen. I stayed there and worked in Air Force Security Service as a high-speed intercept operator, then as a chief of operations for 3 years until I was discharged. They tried to get me to stay in the Air Force, and I said, no, I'm going out and sing on the radio.
His kingdom was divided, couldn't stand. He was weighed in the balance and found wanting. His houses were built upon the sand.
I met my first wife while I was at Brooks Air Force Base in Texas, and we corresponded all through the 3 years I was in Germany.
After getting out of the Air Force, Johnny married Vivian Liberto, and they settled in Memphis. She was Catholic. And in their wedding vows, Johnny agreed that their children would be reared as Catholics. At her urging, Johnny took a 6-month course in Catholicism from a priest in Memphis. He later wrote, "The Catholic instruction gave me an understanding and a tolerance for other faiths, which I value today."
My father's greatest desire when he got into the music business, he wanted to sing gospel songs on the radio. And I think, you know, I think it was only later on that he realized that you know, he might be actually making records in the studio and that they'd be recorded. He just wanted to sing on the radio.
When we went to audition for Sam Phillips, it was still gospel music that we wanted to do. And we auditioned for Sam Phillips at Sun Records with a song called "I Was There When It Happened." So I guess I ought to know.
Well, I was there when it happened, and so I guess I ought to know.
Sun founder Sam Phillips told Johnny gospel music didn't sell.
He just wouldn't do it. He said, no, we just can't sell gospel music. And he was looking at it from a business aspect, and we were looking at it from what we wanted to do.
He finally got Johnny on the map with Rockabilly Records.
Sam Phillips let me make my first record, and then Bingo with Lightbulb Cable, and I said, that's how I'll sing on the radio on the record.
In 1955, Sun Records issued his first record, Hey Porter, and Cry, Cry, Cry. There was so much musical talent centered around Sun that a one-chance jam session came to be known as the Million Dollar Quartet. Johnny, Elvis Presley, and Jerry Lee Lewis dropped in on a Carl Perkins recording session on December 4th of 1956, and the four of them ended up collaborating on a jam session that made musical history. Remarkably, half of the 20 numbers they recorded spontaneously were gospel songs. Cash again approached Sam Phillips about making a gospel album. Sam said no. "I wanted to record gospel music, and I wanted it badly," Cash later wrote. Phillips refused his entreaties to record gospel songs, although he managed to cut two. Belshazzar and I Was There When It Happened would appear on an album many years down the line.
All we wanted to do was gospel stuff. I love singing harmony with John on these gospel songs.
Yes, I know when Jesus saved me,
saved my soul.
The very moment he forgave me,
made me whole.
He took away my heavy burdens. Lord, he gave me peace within.
Peace within.
Satan can't make me doubt it.
I won't doubt it.
It's real and I'm gonna shout it.
I'm gonna shout it.
I was there when it happened.
And so I guess I ought to know.
But then in 1957, for several reasons, we left Sun, and then we signed with Columbia. And at this point, we were able to do a gospel album.
God has my fortune laid away. All the world is full of people with money just to burn, affording all the things in life for which a man might yearn. Some can take life easy, but I live from day to day. God has my fortune laid away.
Laid away.
I search for sunshine every day, but there always comes the rain. The hope over my horizon was smoke without a flame. Pockets that stay empty, dreams that go astray. God has my fortune laid away.
God has my fortune laid away, laid away.
How often I have wondered why some things have to be. Some people live in riches, while some live more like me. The more I try to work and save, the more I have to pay. But God has my fortune laid away.
Laid away.
I search for sunshine every day, but there always comes the rain. The hope over my horizon was smoke without a flame. Pockets that stay empty, dreams that go astray. But God has my fortune laid away.
One new element entered his life. June Carter began touring with Ocascio in 1962. June had strong feelings for him, which she kept in check as long as she was married to someone else. She would become the one stabilizing factor in John's erratic life. Cash later wrote that he, quote, first laid eyes on June Carter when I was 18 on a Dias High School senior class trip to the Grand Ole Opry. I'd liked what I heard of her on the radio, and I really liked what I saw of her from the balcony of the Ryman Auditorium. The next time I saw her was 6 years later. I walked over to her and said, you and I are going to get married someday. Unquote.
June was definitely John's staff from that first time on. I mean, he leaned on her, and she cared for him. And she cared for him through some of the worst periods in his life.
June poured her mixed feelings about John into the song Ring of Fire, which became a number one hit for him in 1963. June had been pursued by the likes of Elvis Presley and the actors James Dean, Marlon Brando, and Lee Marvin, but she fell for the unpredictable Johnny Cash. She said about the song Ring of Fire, "I felt like I had fallen into a pit of fire and I was literally burning alive."
Well, after we went to Columbia, our touring was almost nonstop, and by now we're pretty well known all over the United States and Canada, not necessarily all over the world. And so we started touring with what we call Grand Ole Opry package shows. We had been driving a long ways from out in Texas to get to Georgia to do a show. We'd already been out for about a week, and we were so tired, and we were on the side of the stage, and they were getting ready to introduce us. And John said, "I'm so tired." And so the fiddle player reached in his pocket and pulled out some little pills. He said, "Here, take one of these and you'll be just fine." But John took it. Then the next day he talked about it. He said, "We're gonna have to get us some of those things."
When I took my first ones, I said, "This is what God meant for me to have in this world. This was invented for me." Honestly thought it was a blessing, a gift from God, these pills were. Then I finally found out it's the devil in disguise.
At first, he had them totally under control. But as time went along, they started getting out of control.
With success in Nashville and the accompanying treadmill of nonstop touring, Cash turned more and more to the trucker's friend, speed. He continued his steady pill diet and began missing dates. He was arrested in El Paso, Texas in 1965 for trying to smuggle in hundreds of amphetamine pills and tranquilizers from Mexico. His original police mugshot remains on the internet. He later wrote his regret about pill use. "The worst thing about it was that every pill I took was an attempt to regain the wonderful natural feel of euphoria I experienced the first time, and therefore not a single one of them, not even one among the many thousands that slowly tore me away from my family and my God and myself, ever worked." When he got back to Nashville, he freaked out at a Grand Ole Opry gig and smashed all the stage footlights. The Opry fired him that night, and he borrowed June Carter's new Cadillac, got pilled up again and drunk and erected. Not long thereafter, he was arrested for picking flowers in public in Starkville, Mississippi. He later wrote the song, Starkville City Jail, about that experience.
The jailer threw my pills up on the counter, and he said, "You take the pills, go ahead and kill yourself if you want to." He said, "It's your God-given right to do that if you'd like to do it." But also, he said, "My wife is a big fan of yours." And he said, "When I went home last night and told her I had Johnny Cash in my jail, she cried all night." And he said, "I don't want to see you anymore."
"Touring and drugs were what I did," Cash later wrote. Besides his voracious appetite for pep pills, Cash also had to deal with a diminishing supply. In the 1960s, the American Medical Association woke up to the perils of prescribing unlimited amphetamines, and getting drugs started to be a full-time job, especially for a traveling man. Vivian divorced him, and he moved into a Nashville apartment with Waylon Jennings during their lost year, when they hid their pill stashes from each other, each thinking the other didn't know what was going on. Not long thereafter, as he later wrote, he was a walking vision of death. June Carter began trying to point him toward redemption.
So much of my father's interior struggles were in isolation. He would go off into the wilderness and sort of spend his time alone. And it, you know, it's, I think that that's where a lot of his change took place. It was interior. And one of those times was when he crawled into a cave near Chattanooga, Nickajack Cave, and he crawled into that cave basically to die with a guitar and, you know, and a lot of drugs, and just didn't intend on coming out. And I think he got in there and he found a great loneliness. He found a great sadness. And I believe that he also found a great desire to live. And when he came out of that cave, he went to meet my mother, and she was there to help lift him up. But he had to search to find his way out of that cave, because he nearly got lost in there, and he nearly did die, because when he decided he wanted to live, he was afraid it was too late, because it was dark and scary in there, and he didn't know how to get out. So he just wandered around until he finally found the way out.
Soon after that, he told his mother that God had saved him from killing himself. He told her he was ready to commit himself to him and do whatever it took to get off drugs. He wasn't lying.
He was frail and thin and had beaten himself to a pulp. And he also had a great desire to be with my mother, and he knew that she wouldn't be with him unless he changed. So he sort of locked himself in his own house.
He had recently bought a spectacular new house overlooking Old Hickory Lake, and he kicked pills there, with June and her parents caring for him and insulating him.
With the help of my mother and with the help of Pastor Floyd Gressett, he did get off of the speed and the barbiturates and the amphetamines. He got off of all those drugs at that time, and I believe that he had the desire to be clear, and he had the desire for connection with God again.
Cash proposed marriage to June on stage at a concert in London, Ontario in 1968, and she accepted. They were married the following March 1st. That August, his guitarist, Luther Perkins, died in a house fire.
Without a doubt, one of the greatest people that ever lived. Easy going, was everybody's friend, everybody loved him.
We lived together, we slept together, we rode together, we sang together, we played together, we did everything together. And all of a sudden, one of us is gone.
He loved the song, How Great Thou Art. And it was because of Luther that we wound up doing that show, that song, almost every night on the show.
We sang at his funeral, and we sang How Great Thou Art for him one last time.
In 1968, against Columbia Records' objections, he released the album Johnny Cash at Folsom Prison, followed in 1969 by the album Johnny Cash at San Quentin. The latter included one of his favorite gospel songs that he wrote. He turned the water into wine.
We went into the little town of Cana, just over the hills from Nazareth. And there's a church that sits over the cistern where the water came from that Christ turned to wine, where the first miracle was performed. We went into the church, saw the cisterns. You can hear the sounds of the water in there, hear the echo. I was so impressed when I came out of the church. If I ever had an inspiration, I had one then from seeing what I had just seen and heard. And I said under my breath, he turned the water into wine of all things. On the way to Tiberias in the car, in the next few minutes, I wrote this song. He turned the water into wine. He turned the water into wine. In the little Cana town, the word went all around that he turned the water into wine. Well, he walked upon the Sea of Galilee. He walked upon the Sea of Galilee. Shouted far and wide, he calmed the raging tide and walked upon the Sea of Galilee. He turned turned the water into wine, didn't my Lord now? He turned the water into wine. In the little Cana town, the word went all around that he turned the water into wine. He fed the hungry multitude.
Didn't he, brother?
He fed the hungry multitude. With a little bit of fish and bread, they said everyone was fed.
My pal.
He fed the hungry multitude. He turned the water into wine, didn't the carpenter from Nazareth? He turned the water into wine. In the little Cana town, the word went all around that he turned the water into wine.
He performed and recorded A Boy Named Sue for the first time at San Quentin. It reached number one on the country charts and number two on the U.S. pop charts. After recording the album, he and June left for Israel, where he recorded part of the upcoming album, The Holy Land. It had a hologram cover of Cash in Jerusalem. Ironically, his two prison albums forever sealed his reputation as outlaw, even while he was pursuing his faith in the Holy Land. On New Year's Eve 1969, Johnny wrote himself a letter, which had become his New Year's habit. It read in part, "You still think about them," meaning his pills, "from time to time. You need to pray more. You hardly ever pray. Big deals ahead in 1969, possibly a network TV show. But the biggest deal you've got going is your family and home. You'd better hang with God if you want the other deals to work out. Your friend Cash." In 1969, the Johnny Cash Show premiered on the ABC network and became a successful musical variety show.
I remember when I was a lad, times were hard and things were bad. There's a silver lining behind every cloud. Just poor people, that's all we were, trying to make a living out of black land. We'd get together in a family circle singing loud. Daddy sang bass.
Mama sang tenor.
Me and little brother would join right in there.
Cause singing seems to help a troubled soul. One of these days it won't be long, I'll rejoin them in a song. I'm gonna join the family circle at the throne. Oh no, the circle won't be broken. By and by, Lord, by and by. Daddy sing bass.
Mama sang tenor.
Me and little brother and John right in there.
In the sky, Lord, in the sky.
We would always do a gospel thing at the end.
And that wasn't easy for him to get past ABC in those days, to close the show with a gospel segment. And we would do it just, we'd do it every night, every week. This was 1969, 70, 71. And
even then, it was starting to be a little bit politically incorrect.
Yeah.
I remember after work, Mama would call in all of us. You could hear us singing for a country mile. Now little brother's done gone on, but I'll rejoin him in a song. We'll be together again up yonder in a little while. Daddy sang bass.
Mama sang tenor.
Me and little brother we join right in there.
Cause singing seems to help a troubled soul. One of these days it won't be long, I'll rejoin them in a song. I'm gonna join the family circle at the throne. Oh no, the circle won't be broken. By and by, Lord, by and by.
Daddy sang bass.
Mama sang tenor.
Me and little brother we join right in there.
In the sky, Lord, in the sky.
Me and little brother
was going right in the sky, Lord, in the sky.
unprecedented move, he had the Reverend Billy Graham appear on his show and turned it into an all-gospel night with a star ensemble of gospel singers.
Oh, Lord, I want to be in that number when the saints go marching in. I am going to march in when the saints go marching in. Oh, Lord, I want to be in that number when the saints go marching in. Now I am just a lonely traveler. I'm plodding through this big wide world of sin. I'm getting ready for that shining city. Oh, when the saints go marching in. Oh, when the saints go marching in. Oh, when the saints go marching in. Oh, Lord, I want to be in that number when the saints go marching in.
It was certainly bold to do a whole gospel show, but I'm sure that ABC was not, you know, jumping up and down New York saying, this is great, we've got a Southern gospel music show going on the network, because there's a good deal of the country, even at that time, that didn't know what Southern gospel music was, and a good deal of them didn't care.
Cash had first met the Reverend Billy Graham over lunch in Hendersonville. Cash was so inspired by the meeting that he wrote the song, What is Truth? Graham also sowed the seed within Cash for what would later become the film, The Gospel Road. They would remain lifelong friends and confidants. In 1971, he began to ponder his musical mission and ended up writing the song, Man in Black.
Well, you wonder why I always dress in black, why you never see bright colors on my back. Wonder why does my appearance seem to have a somber tone? Well, there's a reason for the things that I have on. I wear the black for the poor and the beaten down, living in the hopeless, hungry side of town. I wear it for the prisoner who has long paid for his crime, but is there because he's a victim of the time. I wear the black for those who never read, nor listen to the words that Jesus said, about the way to happiness through love and charity. I believe he's talking straight to you and me. I wear the black for the sick and the lonely old, for the reckless ones whose bad trip left them cold. I wear the black in mourning for the lives that should have been. Each week we lost 100 fine young men. Well, there's things that never will be right, I know, and things need changing anywhere you go. But till we start to make a move to make a few things right, you will never see me wear a suit of white. Oh, I'd love to wear a rainbow every day and tell the world that everything's okay. But I'll try to carry off a little darkness on my back till things are brighter. I'm a man in black.
The 70s were finally good years for Johnny and June. He wrote that the 1970s for me were a time of abundance and growth, not just in terms of finances and property, but personally, spiritually, and in my work. Johnny and June entered into their marriage with daughters of their own, but their first baby together was a special event for them, and they welcomed John Carter Cash as a young prince. On the day of his birth, on March 3rd, 1970, Johnny quit drugs cold turkey again. He had a lifelong link to the dark side of drugs, and had never quite dropped them behind him. But with John Carter's birth, he felt reborn as a man. He said, "The past couple of years have been the happiest of my life. I'm a human being again. I've got the right wife. I'm working steady, and I finally got a son." They took the young prince everywhere with them. When they were on the road, Johnny made time to take his son to zoos and museums and tried to teach him all he could. John Carter recalled that when he was about 3 years old, his parents put him on stage. At the end of Boy Named Sue, Johnny would have him come out to take a bow.
It was not long after, you know, the television series was coming off the air that he went in and made the film Gospel Road and went to Israel with some dear friends and a spiritual dedication.
I never really saw a good movie about Jesus that I really did like, because I didn't think most of the movies I've ever seen about him didn't show him as being human enough as well as being totally divine.
Gospel Road says more about John Cash than anybody could possibly say if you just analyze that entire movie. That is John. That's his beliefs.
But we told the story the way we feel it. We prayed for guidance, for inspiration, to do the right thing.
He wrote the majority of the songs in it. He wrote the movie. He produced the movie. He narrated the movie. We all did the soundtrack for Gospel Road. There's about somewhere around 20 songs in it.
Have a little bread, Simon. Give a little wine, James, my brother. Go ahead and eat, friends, and love one another. Have a good time now, for tomorrow I must die. And I'm never more gonna eat with you again till we eat the marriage supper in the sky. Have a good time, children. Though I'll not be long abiding, better eat now, brother, 'cause tomorrow you'll be hiding, fearing for your lives, fellas, 'cause you followed after me. But after tomorrow you're never gonna fear again. I'm gonna loose the chains and set the captives free.
It was his way of telling the spiritual story of Christ. As sort of a joyous celebration through music.
June plays Mary Magdalene and did a wonderful job. My sister Reba is Mary, the mother of Jesus.
We made our mind up to one thing. Television is wonderful. It did a lot for us and we appreciate that. But this film is a film about the life of Christ, and I don't see a soap commercial or any kind of a commercial in the middle of the life of Christ. So if this film does go on television, we won't have it interrupted with any kind of sponsors.
We may wind up having a good movie just for our family and friends, but that'll be all right.
His new autobiography, Man in Black, sold more than 1 million copies. In the book, Cash wrote that June had always been his guardian angel. He described the book as his spiritual odyssey. He wrote in the book's personal note, "To fellow Christians who feel they have failed and fear there is no hope, it is my promise that this book will show you there is hope."
Here's a song that I wrote a few years ago when I was in Bible school. We took correspondence courses in the Bible, and we studied them on the bus and backstage and in hotel rooms for about 3 years there. And during that period, a lot of songs came out, as songs have always come out of the Bible for writers. But we were traveling one day from Denver to Cheyenne, Wyoming, and going over one hill after another, one hill and valley, and was thinking about the hills and valleys of life. And then finally June said, "How far is it to Cheyenne?" And I said, "I don't know." We topped a hill, and she saw the light. She says, "Over the next hill, we'll be home." And before we got to Cheyenne, I had written the song. She had written it down for me as I gave it to her. One of those that just came to me. Hope you enjoy. Over the next hill, we'll be home. By the way, the land is laid.
I think I'd be safe in saying that over the next hill we'll be home. It's a straight and narrow highway, no detours and no byways, and over the next hill we'll be home. From the prophets I've been hearing, I would say the end is nearing, for I see familiar landmarks all along. By the dreams that I've been dreaming, there will come a great redeeming, and over the next hill we'll be home. I would say there's no mistaking that over the next hill we'll be home. There's a place that we are nearing that so many have been fearing, and over the next hill we'll be home. And when we get there, we're all knowing that we'll find gate is open, and there'll be a refuge from the raging storm. By the dreams that I've been dreaming, there will come a great redeeming, and over the next hill we'll be home.
In 1977, after years of correspondence courses, Cash received a theology degree from the Christian International School of Theology. Over the course of 23 years, he made more than two dozen appearances at Billy Graham Crusades, and he and Graham were a truly imposing pair at the pulpit.
Oh, well, the bear will be gentle, and the wolf will be tame, and the lion shall lay down beside the lamb, yes he will, and the beast from the wild will be led by a little child, and I will be changed, I'll be changed from this creature that I am.
Johnny cut Kris Kristofferson's Why Me, Lord, he said he felt as if it was written just for him.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. I've been so blessed in my life. I want to thank God for the salvation that we've got through accepting Jesus Christ our Lord. And I want to say publicly to you, the folks here gathered tonight, to the fans and to my friends in the music business, Jesus Christ is Lord in my life. Jesus Christ is Lord. Mr. Earl Poobal on piano, Marty Stewart on bass, would like to do a song that kind of ask a question. What did I do to deserve all the blessings you've given me, Lord? Why me, Lord? Why me, Lord? What have I ever done to deserve even one of the blessings I've known? Why me, Lord? What did I ever do that was worth love from you and the kindness you've shown? Lord, help me, Jesus, I've wasted it. So help me, Jesus, I know what I am. Now that I know that I've needed you, so help me, Jesus, my soul's in your hands. Try me, Lord, if you think there's a way that I can repay what I've taken from you. Maybe, Lord, I could show someone else what I've been through myself on my way back to you. Lord, help me, Jesus, I've wasted it. So help me, Jesus, I know what I am. Now that I know that I've needed you, so help me, Jesus, my soul's in your hands. Jesus, my soul's in your hands.
Thank you. Here's June Carter Kay. Sing a song with me, will you?
I'd love to.
Right? This is a song from an album that I have got released right away. It's called The Gospel Singer. But this song, of all the songs, including Boy Named Sue and all the rest of them, the biggest selling sheet music in the last 100 years is this song, Old Rugged Cross. On a hill far away stood an old rugged cross, the emblem of suffering and shame. And I love that old cross, where the dearest and best for a world of lost sinners was slain. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown.
To the old rugged cross I will ever be true. Its shame and reproach gladly bear. And you'll call me someday to that home far away, where his glory forever I'll change.
Sing it with us, choir.
So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down.
Everybody sing.
I will cling to the old rugged cross
For Johnny, being on the Crusades validated his spiritual progress. He was able to make a public witness to his salvation and his renewed faith.
And I just wanted to say, in case anybody had any doubt, that I'm a Christian, and I'm awfully proud to say so.
Pragmatically, it was good for both men's missions. Each was exposed to a new audience. Cash's fans came to the Graham Crusades to see their hero, and the Graham audience got to see the spiritual side of a musical outlaw they had only heard tall tales about.
Somebody said, "Well, you realize, John, he draws more people than you do at his shows." And he said, "Yeah, it's because he's got a better sponsor than I do." But as it turned out, they both had the same sponsor, and they turned out to be good friends.
My father, you know, when he was on the Billy Graham Crusades, reached out to so many people and brought people in, probably to the Crusades, to see him that wouldn't have been there otherwise. And Billy said, "Those are your fans, Johnny. Those are the ones that I'm after," you know, with the uproarious response from my dad coming out on the stage.
I'm just an old chunk of coal, but I'm gonna be a diamond someday. I'm gonna grow and glow till I'm so blue pure perfect. Gonna put a smile on everybody's face. Oh, but I'm gonna kneel and pray every day, lest I should become vain along the way. I'm just an old chunk of coal now, Lord, but I'm gonna be a diamond someday.
John could do a song that's spiritual in nature and not necessarily in lyric. Because he could take a song about an everyday situation and give a spiritual essence to it.
Teach a lesson.
Teach a lesson.
Make a point.
And he could capture you.
I'm gonna learn the right words to talk. I'm gonna search and find a better way to walk. I'm gonna spit and polish my old rough edge itself till I get rid of every single flaw. Oh, I wanna be the world's best friend. I'm gonna go around shaking everybody's hand. I'm just an old chunk of coal now, Lord, but I'm gonna be a diamond someday. I'm just an old chunk of coal now, Lord, but I'm gonna be a diamond someday.
Throughout his life, Cash continued to speak out about causes that mattered to him. At a concert in Charlotte, North Carolina, which was then involved in an intense political debate about legalizing liquor by the drink, Johnny spoke out against legalizing drinks on demand. He and June were both very outspoken about alcohol abuse.
Hey, baby, I wanted to say something, too.
Okay.
I had said that I won't get into your politics, and I won't do that. But I'd like just like to tell you about us as entertainers. We've been traveling around 12, 15 years entertaining, and there's a lot of us in this outfit that have tried just a little bit of everything. Carl Perkins, 4 years ago, gave up drinking after a problem with drinking that almost destroyed his life as well as his marriage. And a drink of liquor, to be able to buy a drink of liquor and to take a drink of liquor would mean death and ruin for Carl Perkins. It would mean that for a lot of us in this show. All these fine people have learned a lesson. There's not a one in this outfit that drinks at all. As far as we're concerned, by the drink is drinking. Oh, well, I'm tired and so weary, but I must go along till the Lord comes and calls me away. Oh, yes, and the morning so bright, and the lamb is alight, and the night is as black as the sea. Oh.
In 1983, he was attacked by an ostrich in his wild animal park in Tennessee. Several of his ribs were crushed and his stomach was torn open.
Male ostriches get a little aggressive, and it's sort of lucky he didn't kill him. After that, my father's, he did become more addicted to pain pills and started to struggle, you know, more so with his addiction.
By December, he recognized that he needed help for his pill addiction and checked into the Betty Ford Clinic to try to kick his habit.
In Betty Ford, I went through a thing called grief therapy to get rid of any unresolved grief that I might have for anybody. And I went through that for Jack about 40 years past the fact.
His friend Waylon Jennings later said of Cash, he was a prisoner of what he became. Sometimes hillbillies can't handle all this. In 1986, Johnny published his novel, Man in White, about the Apostle Paul, which he had been writing when the ostrich attack sidelined him. In his introduction to the book, Johnny explained some of his motivation. Paul had become my hero. He was invincible. He made it his life's mission to conquer and convert the adulterous, pagan world over to Jesus Christ. And he did everything he planned. He smiled at his persecutions, he said. Because of Jesus Christ, he had learned to be content in whatever state he was in. Johnny further said he was interested in trying to tap that strength Paul found, the power of God that's inside me, that's there for me if only I seek it.
Many people are saying that it's the best book on the life of the Apostle Paul up until his conversion that they've ever read. Some people say they never understood Paul before they read this book. It's called Man in White. You know, he wrote a book called Man in Black. We know why. But this is a novel about the life of the Apostle Paul. And it's a wonderful book. And we welcome today these two people whom we love with all of our hearts, and they've been in many of our crusades. And let's welcome them here today to Tallahassee, Johnny and June Cash.
You sing along with me, will you?
Well, I don't know it too well, but they know it just about as well as I do, the choir. So if you know it, just hang in there and hum.
We got cue cards out here, baby.
Okay.
This is a song that came, well, actually, out of my studies about Paul. There were so many things that I wanted to know about Paul, and I said, one of these days, I'm just going to sit down and ask him. So I wrote the song. One of these days, I'm going to sit down and talk to Paul. One of these days I'm gonna sit down and talk to Paul. One of these days I'm gonna sit down and talk to Paul. I will ask him about his journeys and he'll tell me about them all. One of these days I'm gonna sit down and talk to Paul. He will introduce me to Luke and Timothy. He will introduce me to Luke and Timothy. I will be so glad to meet them, think they'll be glad to meet me. He will introduce me to Luke and Timothy. Sing. One of these days I'm gonna sit down and talk to Paul. One of these days I'm gonna sit down and talk to Paul. I will ask him about his journeys and he'll tell me about them all. One of these days I'm gonna sit down and talk to Paul.
His trip to Philippi. How he and Silas felt at Philippi. And in that miracle at midnight, how the jails rolled open wide.
They sing at Philippi.
One of these days I'm gonna sit down and talk to Paul.
One of these days I'm gonna sit down and talk to Paul. I will ask him about his journeys, and he'll tell me about them all. One of these days I'm gonna sit down and talk to Paul. I'm gonna ask him if he ever went to Spain.
I'm gonna ask him if he ever went to Spain. I will find out if he made it, and I'll check out his secret pain. One of these days I'm gonna sit down and talk to Paul.
One of these days I'm gonna sit down and talk to Paul.
Sing it out.
One of these days I'm gonna sit down and talk to Paul.
He will tell me about his journeys, I will ask him about them all.
One of these days I'm gonna sit down and talk to Paul.
One of these days I'm gonna sit down and talk to Paul. Talk to Paul. One of these days I'm gonna sit down and talk. Sit down and talk to Paul. He'll ask about his journeys and he'll tell me about them all.
One of these days I'm gonna sit down and talk to Paul.
One of these days I'm gonna sit down and talk to Paul.
One of these days I'm gonna sit down and talk to Paul.
In July of 1986, after he had been with the label for 28 years, Columbia Records dropped Cash after he had gone a decade without having a major hit. He later said he felt adrift creatively. He recorded for a time for Mercury Records with no success, although a 1990 reunion with the Highwaymen, Cash, Willie Nelson, Waylon Jennings, and Kris Kristofferson did well, but no more came of that. After a bypass operation in 1988, Cash said he went through a near-death experience with visions of heaven so intense that he was angry and felt cheated of paradise when he awoke. That experience inspired him to record a reading of the entire New Testament on a 19-hour series of audio cassettes and CDs. He said he did it because his mother long urged him to do so.
He was excited by the idea initially, because for one thing, he would read every word of it aloud, and that would be committed into his memory and into his consciousness in a way that it never had been before.
Welcome to Israel.
Thank you.
When he and June made their fifth return visit to the Holy Land, they decided to film it for a documentary. The resulting film and album titled Return to the Promised Land showed their travels and their talks with local residents. They toured holy sites and sang many gospel songs to capture their vision of the Holy Land.
My mother's favorite song was I Won't Have to Cross Jordan Alone. And here on the banks of the Jordan River, it's wonderful to be able to sing it for her memory. When I come to the river at the ending of day and the last winds of sorrow have blown, there'll be somebody waiting to show me the way. I won't have to cross Jordan alone. I won't have to cross Jordan alone. Jesus died all my sins to atone. In the darkness I see, he'll be waiting for me. I won't have to cross Jordan alone. Would you walk that second mile, turn a frown with a smile? Would you lift a lowly heart about to break? Would you also give your cloak to one who took away your coat? What on earth will you do for heaven's sake? Would you feed the poor in spirit and befriend the persecuted? Will you show the bound how all their chains can break? Did you sow the proper seed? Will you walk out among the weeds? What on earth will you do for heaven's sake? Did you turn the other cheek? Are you counted with the meek? Did you give a little more than you could take? Would you shine your little light for the children of the night? What on earth will you do for heaven's sake? Would you feed the poor in spirit and befriend the persecuted? Will you show the bound how all their chains can break? Did you sow the proper seed? Will you walk among the weeds? What on earth will you do for heaven's sake?
My father was in great physical pain. At that time, he had had jaw surgery done, and he had neurological damage to his bones. But we found such great healing on that trip. We all did. We all got closer together as a family. I think my dad and my mother needed to go back there again for their own peace. And they felt like they had more of a story to tell about their relationship with the Holy Land.
We've got a preacher traveling on the road with us now on our shows that we call him our own personal guru. He's a fundamental preacher, though, don't get me wrong. Reverend Jack Shaw from Johnstown, Pennsylvania, travels with us.
In Branson, I started working with him full time. John and June both wanted me to do a Bible study in their dressing room before each show. And I did that. It would be like a 5-minute Bible study. And then we'd form a prayer circle and pray.
And it's just the daily devotion I found in my life, the daily devotion, prayer, and Bible study is so vital to Christian growth. I here dedicate myself today to more of that, to trying to be a little more humble and pray more and seek His face and to study His Word. That's my vow this day. Thank you.
When they heard Johnny Cash talk about God, the Bible, and about faith, people that could not be helped or would not want help responded, and they came and talked. They thought, if it's okay for him, it's okay for us.
Here's the first song we ever did on the Billy Graham Crusade in Knoxville, Tennessee, a long time ago, The Old Account.
We're still trying to settle it.
There was a time on earth when in the books of heaven an old account was standing for sins yet unforgiven.
My name was at the top and many things below, but I went unto the keeper and I settled it long ago.
Long ago.
Down on my knees.
Long ago.
I settled it all.
Yes, the old account was settled long ago. And the record's clear today, for he washed my sins away. And the old account was settled long ago.
Well, the old account was large and growing every day. And I was always sinning, and I never tried to pray.
But when I looked ahead and saw such pain and woe, well, I knew I better get it settled. And I settled it long ago, long ago.
Down on my knees.
Long ago.
I settled it all.
Yes, the old account was settled long ago. And the record's clear today, for he washed my sins away. And the old account was settled long ago. Now sinners, seek the Lord, repent of all your sins. This he has commanded, if we would enter in. And then if you should live 100 years below, well, you know you got it settled, 'cause you settled it long ago, long ago. Long ago.
I settled it all.
Yes, the old account was settled long ago. And the record's clear today, for he washed my sins away. And the old account was settled long ago.
God
God bless you. Thank you.
In the early 1990s, with his recording career foundering, he found himself re-emerging into the American music scene when rock producer Rick Rubin told him, let's record whatever you want to do any way you want to do it.
Part of the beauty in those American recording records, they are a mutual effort, of course, from my father and Rick. You don't necessarily produce Johnny Cash, you let him do what he does, and then you just sort of help put it all together and clarify it. Rick gave him freedom to do what he wanted to do, to follow his desire. And a few of the songs are so acutely Johnny Cash and beautiful and you know, inspirational and one of a kind. You know, it's a great blessing. And another instance of him being so cool that he draws the listener in and then gives them the message, in the subject matter of the song.
The success of the album American Recordings revived his career and brought him a new generation of fans. It also won him a Grammy for Contemporary Folk Album of the Year. In 1997, after years of occasional hospitalizations, Cash's health began to fail in earnest. His diabetes was complicated by serious nerve problems, and he was hospitalized at Baptist Hospital in Nashville with severe pneumonia. He had completed and published his second autobiography. In it, he was beginning to sense his mortality and wanted to leave a mark of where he was in life. It also suggests that he was reassuring himself. He wrote in 1994, I made an alliance with Rick Rubin and made my American Recordings albums. According to the media at the time, that caused an overnight change in my status from Nashville has-been to hip icon. Whatever they called me, I was grateful. It was my second major comeback. The minor ones have been too many to count.
As far as John's later career, as him cutting more hit records right up till the day he passed away, never surprised us, because John was born into this world with something to say, and I think if he were still here, he would still be saying it. We were never surprised at any success that he had, because we knew how prolific he was.
I come to the banks of the Jordan River, and it has kind of a special meaning to me. Seems like when I was a child, I'd think about crossing the Jordan, and I was always going straight to heaven. And people come here for many reasons, to be baptized or just to find peace of mind by this river. And there is a peace of mind for me in the way that I believe, knowing that if I'm going to cross this Jordan River, that I got somebody to cross it with, or I'll be waiting there when he does finally cross it. Maybe we'll do it together. Anyway, John, I'd like to sing you a song that's kind of a love song for us, but also a spiritual in a way. It's the Far Side Banks of Jordan.
I believe my steps are growing wearier each day. Got another journey on my mind. Lures of this old world have ceased to make me want to stay. And my one regret is leaving you behind.
It proves to be his will that I am first to cross, and somehow I've a feeling it will be. When it comes your time to travel, likewise don't be lost, for I will be the first one that you'll see.
And I'll be waiting on the far side banks of Jordan. I'll be sitting, drawing pictures in the sand. And when I see you coming, I will rise up with a shout and come running through the shallow water, reaching for your hand. Through this life we labor hard to earn our meager fare. It's brought us trembling hands and failing eyes.
I will rise up with a shout and come running through the shallow water, reaching for your hand.
In 2001, June's good health began to turn and a heart condition became apparent. She was fitted with a pacemaker, but her condition did not seem to warrant undue concern. The next year, June underwent heart valve replacement surgery. The surgery appeared at first to be a success, but unexpected complications arose from the surgery, and she went into a coma at the age of 73 in Nashville. The family and the music community were devastated by her death. Looking frail and using a wheelchair, Johnny attended June's service at First Baptist Church in Hendersonville. He forced himself up out of the chair to kneel by her open coffin to say a final goodbye after 35 years of marriage to his beloved. He never again slept in their marital bed, instead choosing to bed down in his office. He talked every day to June's picture.
Part of him yearned so to be with her again. He missed her so much, he talked to her every day. He loved her so tenderly. And when she was gone, it was just part of him was gone.
Way home from her funeral, he looked at me and said, "John Carter, I've got to get in the studio." And I said, "Okay, let's go." And 4 days later, we were in the studio recording music. That was his therapy. Music was his solace. It's where he found his peace. It's where he found some sort of peace. And it was in listening to songs and then going in the studio and singing those songs that he found the greatest peace.
Mostly blind, becoming deaf, afflicted with heart trouble and diabetes, and many other serious ailments, Cash willed himself to get back into the studio to finish the final album, because June would want him to.
I'll start right there. We're at the instrumental break.
Okay.
I'd like to go from there, because the second half I'm having so much trouble with.
Like Job in the Bible, a tragic figure Cash had long studied and identified with, he persevered despite his afflictions because of his enduring faith. His faith never left him. The weakness and frailty of his voice on the album underscore the impact of the last Johnny Cash songs.
You want to work on a section at a time?
Yeah, let me try that.
Less than 4 months later, Johnny Cash died at the age of 71. He was buried next to June in Hendersonville, Tennessee. His tombstone bears words from Psalm 19:14. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer.
Are you bitter?
Bitter?
Yeah, angry. No. I mean, you know, you're a young guy, you're only 70.
No, I'm not bitter. Why should I be bitter? I'm thrilled to death with life. Life is, the way God has given it to me, is just a platter, a golden platter of life laid out there for me. It's been beautiful.
You have no anger at the, why did God do this to me?
Oh, no, no. I'm the last one that would be angry at God.
Johnny Cash lived and loved and sinned and repented on a larger-than-life scale throughout his whole life. In the end, he finally realized that his faith would carry him through. And it seems that it did.
Tempted and tried, we're off me to wonder why it should be thus all the day long. While there are others living about us, never molested, coming in glory, when he comes from his home in the sky, then we shall meet him in that bright mansion, and we'll understand it all by and by.